The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan, 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com. This is Kerry Lutz. You're listening to the Financial Survival Network. And if you're wondering, is it time to leave? Is it time to think about going elsewhere? My next guest is an expert in that. He's written a book, Creature of Jekyll Island. Mr. G. Edward Griffin is with us now. Mr. Griffin, hello.
Hello, Kerry. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing great, and a hearty welcome to all of our freedom lovers out there, because you're probably close to number one in my book.
Oh, well, thank you so much for that.
Well, so the $64 trillion question on everyone's mind, and you're probably in a better position from your knowledge of history, is we're heading towards this totalitarian train wreck. Freedoms are eroding. People are really concerned. It seems like the so-called democratic process has complete state of failure. What do people do? Do they get out of Dodge, or do they stay and fight?
Well, first of all, I'd like to comment on your appraisal of the fact that the so-called democratic process is in self-destruct. And yes, I certainly agree with that. And I'm especially glad that you said the so-called democratic process. Actually, it is a democratic process, but it by saying so-called, it puts a big question mark about the value of it or the understanding of what it really is. You know, our founding fathers were very clear about a democracy. When they drafted the Constitution, they made it very clear, especially in their private debates that led up to the creation of the Constitution, they made it very clear that they did not want a democracy. They thought a democracy was perhaps the worst possible kind of government you could possibly create, you know. And they talked about that. And they warned that, God help us, they said, if America should ever adopt a, become a democracy, because they always self-destruct throughout history. There's a certain point, and they knew it well because they were historians, there's a certain point in every democracy where the people discover that they can vote themselves into the pocketbooks of others. And, you know, if you just have a majority, you can plunder, legally plunder the minority. And therefore, the predator class is attracted to that. And they become the politicians. And they promise the people to do exactly what I just described, the legalized plunder. And so at that point, it's a runaway train, as you said. There's no stopping it. Every time it's happened in history, it has self-destructed, because you cannot sustain that. So that's what we're going through today, and we were warned about it by the founding fathers, but unfortunately, they don't teach that in school, and mainly because the schools are in the hands of the very predator politicians I've just described, and they don't want the voters to understand that, because while it's in that mode of self-destruct, and it does take several generations, the people who are riding that runaway engine are doing very well. You know, they're living high, and the legalized plunder business is very good. It's an old saying, they say that crime doesn't pay. Well, that's nonsense. Of course it pays. Otherwise, there wouldn't be any criminals. and democracy, so-called democracy, pays the plundered the plunderers. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there. They wouldn't be doing their thing. So anyway, I thought I would just comment and say that I certainly agree with you on that. And the question arises, well, can you reverse it? Because you have to think about that if you're going to decide whether you want to stand and fight or whether you want to run and so forth. And I personally think that it can be reversed. Now, why would I think a silly thing like that when it has never been reversed before in history? And my reason for thinking so is that there's something new that hasn't existed before in history, and that is instant and mass communication. And we're talking primarily about the internet. We're talking about radio programs such as yours. We're talking about the ability of the small person, the individual voter, an individual writer like myself, an individual commentator, newscaster such as yourself. We can, because we have these technological tools, we can make our voices heard and we can leverage ourselves much more so than previously in history. I mean, there was a time when you had to be a, you know, like a Thomas Paine, and there were very few people who had both the ability to express themselves and also have access to the printing press where they could, you know, print up their essays in the form of pamphlets and distribute them and so forth. Even that was kind of a major breakthrough at the time of the American Revolution. We had a few pamphleteers. Prior to that, before the printing press, it was very, very difficult for anybody to make it through and have their voices heard. Now we have this possibility to multiply our efforts and ramp up. So that's a positive sign. And at the by the same token, we know that the forces of totalitarianism are very concerned about that technology, and they're working very diligently now to take control of the internet and to put clamps on means of communication such as we are using now. And they're doing this always in the name of some crisis or some supposed good for the people. They're saying, well, we've got to control, you know, child pornography. We've got to control terrorism on the internet. We've got to make it sure that these bad terrorists don't communicate with each other. And we've got to control, you know, drugs and things like that. And so therefore, give us control of the internet so we can license everybody and tell, you know, give permits to only those who say the right things at the right time. So that process is going on, and as part of our battle, a very important part, and the outcome of that particular contest will likely determine the outcome of whether or not we can turn this around. I still think it's possible, and, you know, I always have a feeling that it's a good idea to, if you're not sure whether something should work, you should try it. you don't just say, well, I don't think it'll work. And especially if it's important, you think, well, it's something's got to work, and I don't know if this will work or not, but I'm not going to just sit here and wonder. I'm going to give it the old college try. So I think that's very important to have as an attitude, is let's give it a try. You never know. You might surprise ourselves. We might be able to turn this thing around. Now, if we assume the worst case scenario, and we are not able to regain control of the system and put people back into positions of authority and power who don't have an axe to grind except for freedom, well then you have to figure out what are you going to do about it. And I have to say that in all honesty, we cannot take that option off the table. I mean, we cannot take that possibility off of the list of, you know, consideration, because it begins increasingly more and more to look like it just may continue down that track, because the people who are making the primary decisions, the ones who still hold the major power positions in society, meaning primarily the government agencies and the media and the educational system and that sort of thing, they're still the same group of people, by and large, that have put us into the mess. Nothing has really changed. You know, there's a lot of rhetoric. Election time, you've got this phony battle between Republicans and Democrats here in the United States, and they come up with some pretty good rhetoric, but you notice that nothing really ever changes regarding regardless whether it's Republicans in power or the Democrats in power. Maybe small things change, but the big things do not change. And by the big things, I'm talking about our monetary system being based on a fiat money system like the Federal Reserve has created, a politically based system whereby international banking cartels and politicians in partnership are able to create unlimited amounts of money to fund themselves and to fund their projects and to fund their control mechanisms. And they just keep passing the cost on to the people, not in the form of taxes so much as it is in the form of inflation. So the monetary system is extremely important to this totalitarian structure because it's the means by which it is automatically and easily funded. If you take away the money, of course, then the whole system, well, I won't say it collapses, it just morphs into a military system whereby the guns and the bayonets become the primary mechanisms of control rather than the checkbook. Either way, it's the same group in control, but they prefer the checkbook because it's a more genteel weapon and more people respond to it, and there's kind of a reward mechanism there as well as a punishment mechanism. In other words, if you're on the right side of these issues, if you're part of the team, so to speak, and the control mechanism is money, well, then you can live very well. You become fabulously wealthy, whereby if you are on the wrong side of the team or you're the opponent of the totalitarian group, well, then you're cut off. Especially they're hoping now to have everybody chipped and have no paper money. It'll all be electronic money. So they'll be able to throw a switch. If you step out of line, they'll throw a switch and you won't be able to buy a loaf of bread. You won't be able to buy a cup coffee, much less perform any reasonable economic activity. So it's the ultimate means of control, much more effective than guns and bayonets, because you can escape guns and bayonets if you run and hide and all that sort of thing, but you can't escape having to buy food, shelter, and clothing, and somewhere down the line it catches up with you. So anyway, I'm a little bit off the track. And all these things come to mind when I know we're headed to the big question: is should we run or should we stand? But what I'm trying to say is that we have to be realistic about the world in which we live before we can have a realistic attitude about what we do about it. You know, if we live in a fantasy world and we refuse to face reality, then There's no reason to think that we're going to come up with a workable solution to the problem, if any at all. So anyway, what I'm saying is that I don't underestimate the seriousness and the direness of our problem. So putting all that aside, maybe we can come back afterwards to what I think specifically we should do about it. But let's now finally deal with the big question that you raised. Should we get out of Dodge? Should we go somewhere else, or should we stand and face the corrupt sheriff? You know, the sheriff has taken. Should we? The sheriff has taken over the town. He's got the police. He's got the whole system, the courts, the judges, everything. He owns the newspaper and so forth. Now, what do we do about it? Do we stand and fight the sheriff, or do we get out of Dodge? Well, first of all, the question is, where do you go? If you realize that the problems we're facing today are not just limited to Dodge City, but they're in Center City too, and they're in Mainesville, and they're all over the world. The system of collectivism and corruption that we've been talking about is now international in scope. And to my knowledge, there is no place in the world that you can go to where you wouldn't be facing pretty much the same problems, if not worse, actually. There are places, a lot of places in the world where, you know, it's even worse than here. And I was just appalled to find out some years ago when I visited Australia and New Zealand, I thought, here is a place now. This is like the frontier of America was, you know, rugged individualism and so forth. And it's true that the people in those countries do have a lot of that spirit left. It's like where we were maybe 20 or 25 or 30 years ago. But their governments have already been taken over by the same mentality, the same predator politicians in partnership with the same corrupt bankers. And they're part of this thing that they like to call the New World Order. And it's already there. And in many ways, it's even more so there than it is here. So I don't know of any place to go. And if you put yourself back in the time of the American Revolution, for example, and these are the two patterns I think we have to look at. The one is to stand like the colonists did. They stood against the redcoats. They didn't say, well, we're going to go to Canada or we're going to go to Mexico. They said, no, this is our land. And by golly, we're going to defend our land, and we're going to fight. We're going to stand. We're not going to take this. And they stood firm. And that's the one model. Had they not done that, of course, we would probably be part of the British Empire, although in all honesty, the British have been influenced by pretty much the same mentality that we're talking about. And the unfortunately, the British Empire, they threw it away. They threw away all their greatest colonies, not because they had to or you know there was any great military reason to, but because they decided it was time to break up the great nations of the world and create subsets which could be easily merged into this new world order. But anyway, we probably would have, as a colony, have been turned loose eventually by Britain itself, like they turned loose of all of their other colonies. But nevertheless, in terms of the American Revolution, the colonists didn't know any of that, and nor did the British at that time. So it was a question of, do you stand and defend your lives, your liberty and property, or do you run? That's the one model. They stood, and we're very grateful that they did. On the other hand, the other model is the Jews in Germany saw the totalitarian system come, and many of them got out, and you know, they came to America. There was some place to go. People like, it was very famous people, Einstein, and a lot of Jews came to America, and they saved their lives, and much of what they had in the way of material possessions were, as many of those who stayed behind, of course, were rounded up and perished in the concentration camps. And so in that instance, we say, well, the ones that got out were smart. So which model do we follow? I think that we have no place to go. I think we have an obligation to make a stand. I think that we've got to make it work here. I think we've got to recapture the system. I don't think we can fight the system, by grabbing your muskets and meeting the redcoats at the bridge, because first of all, they don't wear redcoats anymore. In the old days, our enemy came from another land. They had uniforms. They were what we would call foreigners. They invaded our land. They came and you could spot them. Oh, there's one with a red coat. Today, our enemy is among us. They're American citizens. They have citizenship the same as we. You can't tell by looking at them. And, it's more of an attitude. It's a set of values. It's an ideology. Do you believe in the individual, or do you believe in the collective group? Which is more important, individual personal freedoms, or is it the rights of the state that's going to dominate? So it's our enemy now really is not a nation. It's not somebody with a certain uniform. It could be our neighbor, somebody who thinks differently, that wants our property because he thinks that he has a better use for it, and it'd be better for society if he takes control of what we have earned or inherited, and he can administer it in a certain way that he thinks is correct. So that's the kind of battle we're in against this, and that's the same all over the world. So I'm finally getting to my answer to your question, Carrie, which is, I think that in America today, the only sensible, the only practical, the only moral and ethical, only reasonable thing to do is to dig in your heels and do everything possible, focus totally, totally on recapturing the system and returning it to the principles that were originally embedded in the Constitution of our country. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't get out of the way, you know, if you're living in downtown New York or downtown Chicago or Los Angeles, and you have an option of, you know, moving your family to the outskirts a little bit where the population density isn't quite so high, where maybe the chaos, if it's coming, won't be so severe. And it doesn't mean you shouldn't, you know, have food and extra water put away in case the services aren't working for a while. I believe all those things are sensible and good things to do, and you should do that probably anyway, some of it anyway, just because of natural disasters. But that doesn't mean that you should head for the hills with your guns and your groceries and think that by so doing, you're going to really be doing something good for your family or for your country. It's time to stand and stand up and be heard and become active. Now we come to the question of active. How? What do we do? Okay, we're going to stay. What are we going to do? And that's the reason we formed Freedom Force International, is because the plan there is to recapture the system. The system is always in the hands of a few people. Every country throughout every period of history has always been led by less than 3% of the population, and in most cases less than 1% of the population, because most of the masses just are too bovine. They are followers. They follow the lead cow. Wherever the lead cow goes, that's where the herd goes. And so all you have to do is be a lead cow. And this is a fact of life. You may not like it, but people have this herd instinct and they follow their leaders. So the question is, who are the leaders? You'll find that, you know, that less than 1%, well, they gravitate into positions of leadership, of power. The sociologists, you know, call those power centers. We're talking about political parties. We're talking about, you know, the heads of large corporations. We're talking about the media centers, the labor unions, church organizations, you know, all of the largest organizations that have large membership, where the people tend to follow their leaders. Those are the organizations that became the target of the people we were talking about before, the ones who believe in collectivism, the ones that want to get rid of American sovereignty, the ones that like the banking system just the way it is, the ones that are living high on the hog, the ones who are benefiting by this legalized plunder. They like that system. They're the ones in control. They know that in order to make that system work to their benefit, they have to be leaders. They have to be somebody. And so you have organizations like the Council on Foreign Relations in this country, which only has about a little over 4,000 members, and yet literally every major power center in America is dominated by the members of that organization. I mean, they're everywhere of, you know, of importance. Both major political parties are led by members of the Council on Foreign Relations. I mean, most of the presidents of the United States are members of the Council on Foreign Relations. Almost all of the secretaries of state, the secretaries of the Treasury, you know, the Supreme Court, an amazing number of congressmen and senators, the head of the CIA, the FBI, the Defense Department, the head of ABC, CBS, NBC, Turner Broadcasting, Murdoch, all of the great media centers. You look at all the power centers, the labor unions, the think tanks, the great universities, add them up, look who's on the board of directors, the leadership positions, and it's dominated by members of this one single organization, the Council on Foreign Relations. And the Council on Foreign Relations is dedicated to the creation of a world government, which means the United States would not have sovereignty anymore. These people literally are dedicated to the elimination of America as a nation. They're dedicated to that. And it's, everybody knows it. And yet they get ride around in the limousines. They get treated nicely in the news. They're honored. Everybody applauds them. And yet they know that what they're trying to do is eliminate America. And they're loyal to the banking system. And it's a kind of a weird situation. So having said that, what do we do about it? Do we just stand back and say, oh my, look at this. Isn't this terrible what these few people have done? Or do we say, hey, wait a minute, that's the plan. There's the formula. All we have to do is get organized, get smart, get off of our couches, get away from our TV sets, get out there into these organizations, into these power centers, and ourselves become influential, become dominant, be influential, get elected to positions, run for office, become active, get out of our living rooms and out where the action is, and recapture these power centers. Then I think we have a very good chance, maybe in one or two generations, if we do this and set this pattern in motion, we can recapture the system. And that is what I am counting on. And that is the reason we created Freedom Force International. And by the way, Carrie, I'm so glad to hear that you are now a member. And thank you for doing that. If we could just get 1% or near of the population who could do that and follow the strategy which I have just described, we could recapture the system, and we don't have to run. We can take back, which is rightfully ours.
Yeah, and that is a great thing. I'm going to Freedom Fest in the Bahamas next week. And, you know, one of the things we were talking about, democracy, Ron Paul, okay? This is a guy who has nailed the root of this rot to the point where people are really starting to stand up and listen to him. I don't believe he's got a chance of being elected, but he is the only one who's discussing the fundamental issue here, which, you know, Federal Reserve, taxation, welfare, warfare state. What's your take on Ron Paul? How do you perceive his efforts and what he's trying to accomplish?
Well, I think Ron Paul is an outstanding example of the strategy which we have been describing here. He's only one person, right? But he has stood up. He's making his stand, and he's in one of the power centers, of course. He's a congressman. Now, if he weren't in the power center of Congress, and he was just let's just say he was a writer like myself, well, people might listen to him, but they say, oh, well, he's just a writer. He wrote a book. He's trying to sell a book or something, you know. But here he is. He's a member of Congress, and everybody listens. He's one of the lead cows. And so people want to follow congressmen and senators because they think magically when they get elected, somehow they are transformed into something different, you know. But that's the way it works. People like leaders. And Ron Paul is a fabulous example of what we should all be doing. If he were elected, and I think that's not as impossible as it may seem, although I do have to agree it seems unlikely, not because he's unelectable, not because people don't like his message, but because people are cows and they follow, and the media lead cows are telling them that he can't be elected. And so people are saying, oh, I see. Yeah, the media says he can't be elected. Every time I turn on my television set, some commentator says, well, I like Ron Paul, but he could never win. And so they follow that. It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Actually, Ron Paul could win, but not as long as they follow their media leaders. Then he can't win. You know, it's one of those things. So, but if he did, let's just take the positive side. Let's assume that Ron Paul won the election. So what? What can he do? Well, you know, he's surrounded by, 100,000 bureaucrats in Washington, most of whom believe the opposite of what he does. He doesn't have the power to get rid of them. He could, you know, put in the heads of certain departments, but all the bureaucrats under those heads would be working to undo and oppose everything that Ron Paul stands for. And I can assure you that if they didn't block him, they probably would shoot him or find some way to put something very ugly in his coffee cup. So, but one man cannot turn this around. Although, let me finish this by saying I will work very hard to see that he is elected. And if he is elected, it would be a great step forward in this two-generation process I was describing, because it would show that the ideas of individualism and liberty and freedom are very viable. And it'll be like a bright light of hope for all the rest to say, well, let's do more of this, more of this. And so instead of just having a one man elected to the presidency, let's have 100 people or 500 people elected to Congress and the Senate and to the local city hall and to the county supervisors and so forth. And it's that kind of a repopulation of the whole political system that will work, not just one man. So I think if Ron Paul did get some traction, and Lord willing that he should win, even though he as one person couldn't change very much, it would be part of a huge movement, an earthquake, you might say, in the political grounding of this country, and it would move in the direction of a complete reversal. So I'm all for giving it the old college try. As I said before, if you don't try, how do you know? And so I think that would be wonderful, and I support Ron Paul and everything he's doing.
As do I. One thing that's interesting, you know, it all kind of has to start at the local level. In my little town in Westchester, we worked 6 years to throw out people who we felt were inherently corrupt and did not have the best interests of the town at heart, that were, you know, basically all government is at the local level is a system that provides government employees with benefits, pensions, lifetime health insurance. That's their primary purpose, and you know, gives lucrative deals to contractors, and then you know, they go about their merry way and they sprout platitudes that they're doing it for your own good. We finally got them thrown out in town. Now we're going to see what we can really accomplish here, because you know, there was just every imaginable obstacle thrown in our way to do it. But we finally got it done, and now the fun begins.
Well, good for you, Kerry. That's exactly what needs to be done in every community around the country and around the world. This is not just an American problem. It's a worldwide problem. And it's because people haven't paid much attention to the nature of the state. They just assume that all the things they hear are true. They assume that when the state says, well, we're doing this for your good, or we're doing this for the good of society, or we're doing this for the good of the local community, they think, oh, isn't that nice? Instead of saying, wait a minute, why are they? They're not doing this for the good of the community. They're doing it for their own darn good in most cases, not all, but in most cases, if you look at it. And so, but people haven't paid any attention to that. They thought, oh, well, who cares? So there's a little graft. You can't do anything about that. So if you tolerate a little graft and a little corruption, then the next year you tolerate a little bit more, and the next year a little bit more, until finally you've created, or allowed to be created, a system of total corruption, and it comes down and it destroys your life. So the only good thing I can think about that comes from this great worldwide crisis of government right now is that it is forcing people once again to take an interest and to become aware in these ideological issues. Until they do that, there's no chance for reform. And so out of this, I think that the good thing is that people now are willing to listen, and many of them, you don't need much. Remember, it's just 1% approximately. If 1% of the people will say, wait a minute, this is now my obligation to do something about it, well, then I think, you know, we've won the battle right there.
Yeah, totally. And yeah. Freedom Force International, which is what I really like. It's kind of leaderless. I think I like when you say, you know, don't fight City Hall when you could be City Hall. It seems like an idea that it's really an idea whose time has come.
Yeah, it makes so much sense. And, you know, I'm an older guy now, and I get so mad that I didn't think of this or even realize it until after all these years. I was out there fighting the evil empire since the early 1960s. But throughout most of that period, I was repeating one of the great myths of all time. I said, you know, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, to quote Lord Acton. And everybody would say, yeah, that's true. So we thought that power was the problem. And we thought that all you have to do is just speak against power and try and take power away or prevent people from getting power, but never dreamed that we ourselves should hold power, because that seemed, you know, to be counterintuitive. If power is a problem, then why should we try and hold power? And is, then it woke, I woke up one morning, my gosh, if we don't hold power, then the other guys will. Somebody will. They always will. And I remember waking up one morning almost in a cold sweat. It was like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And I sat up in bed and I said, oh, I get it. We lose.
Sure.
We lose. And, you know, power is dangerous. Mm-hmm. But it's kind of like guns. You know, guns are dangerous. Guns kill people. People have accidents with guns, and terrible accidents. The only thing more dangerous than having guns is not having guns.
Sure. Yep.
Because somebody has guns or knives or clubs or something, you know. And if you don't protect yourself, then you lose. You become prey. So this is the same thing with political power. Even though it's dangerous, somebody will always hold political power. It's a question of who. And if you don't like the ones that are holding it now, then you better get in there and become the ones that do. That means that you have a responsibility to make sure that you and those who follow you do not or are not corrupted by that power. And you have to give a lot of thought to setting in motion a system that that if nothing will prevent people from corrupting a political system, but makes it very difficult, such as our founding fathers did when they drafted our Constitution.
Right.
I remember that Thomas Jefferson received a letter from a friend, and it was right after the Constitution was written. And the friend said, well, Mr. Jefferson, now that we have this government, how can we be sure that only good men are elected to office? Yeah. And I remember his reply was quite classic. He said, speak to me not of good men, rather let us bind men down with the chains of the Constitution. In other words, he was saying, what do you mean only good men run for office? What an absurd thought. We know there are going to be bad people running for office. That's the nature of the beast. So what is this good men stuff? No, we know they're going to be bad men, so therefore let's make it impossible for even bad men to do bad things. We write a constitution which lists all the things that these guys cannot do.
Yeah,
and that's what it's all about.
Yeah.
And it worked for 100 years.
Yeah, it worked for a long time when you think about it. But like all systems, entropy sets in, breaks down. So anyway, I encourage, if you're listening, go to freedomforceinternational.org, sign up, because it's hopefully our future that we're trying to protect. I want to thank you, Mr. Griffin, for being with us. It's really been enlightening, because you've been a freedom fighter your whole life, and we get to hear the benefits of all that knowledge that you've acquired over the years.
Well, Kerry, thank you so much, and congratulations to you for doing the work of Freedom Force, to doing the work of just a patriotic American. You know, you're fulfilling your obligation. You're doing what you can do. You're not just sitting on the couch. You're offering a service to people. You're making it possible for them to hear information they wouldn't get otherwise. If everyone... If everyone within that 1%, now we're not talking about the 1% who are the bankers versus the 99%, but we're talking about the 1% who are the freedom lovers. If everyone in that category would do what you're doing, we would no longer have this problem. So thank you for that.
Absolutely. And we will talk to you soon. Thank you so much.
Okay. Goodbye.
Bye.